I'm absolutely delighted that we can now join live from Africa the football broadcaster Oluwashina Okeleji. I think I said that right. I'm not very good at that. We practiced before and I think I just bundled it up, Oluwashina. Apologies for that. But one thing we won't bundle with you is expert knowledge when it comes to the Africa Cup of Nations. It's a very exciting tournament. What we're going to do with Oluwashina this morning is we're going to go through each group, A, B, C, and D, and we're going to talk about some of the big matches, ones that we're looking forward to, potentially who could be going through, and also some of the star players. So we've got Group A. We'll start with Gabon, Guinea-Bissau, Burkina Faso, Cameroon. Lots of interesting things there. Gabon, they reached the quarterfinals last time they hosted. Their opening game is against Guinea-Bissau in that opener on Saturday. How important is Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang to Gabon, Oluwashina?
Hi, good morning, Richard, and thanks for having me on your show. You're talking undoubtedly one of the biggest stars of African football. A lot of people felt he should have won the African Footballer of the Year, but who was going to deny Riyad Mahrez? He had a fantastic season with Leicester City, he won the Premier League title, and he was undoubtedly one of the stars of African stars in Europe that season. So Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang is the poster boy of Gabonese football. He's the poster boy of this tournament because Gabon, remember, they co-hosted this same tournament with Equatorial Guinea in 2015. So everyone is looking at Gabon, in 2012. So everyone is actually looking at Gabon and saying Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang has a massive role to play in how far the host can go. They have a better way to start their tournament. They've been giving debutants, that is Guinea-Bissau. Guinea-Bissau, they are known as the African wild dog. They are, it's amazing why you would say a team is the African wild dog, but they've never been at the African Cup of Nations tournament. They are debutants, like I said earlier. Gabon will be facing them in that opening match on Saturday, and everyone will be looking and see how the hosts are going to get started with that one. And also remember, in that same group, you have Cameroon. Cameroon are four times African champions. A lot of people in the world know Cameroon because of their exploit at the 1990 World Cup. They stretched England all the way in that quarterfinals. They became the first African side to reach the quarterfinal stage. So everyone is looking at Cameroon. But that Cameroon that you're talking about, that I'm talking about in 1990, is not the same Cameroon that we have right now. They have a name that is domineering. They call them the Indomitable Lions. And that's why they've won the African Cup of Nations four times. But now, the Lions are really, really struggling in their World Cup qualification. They made it to Gabon in fine form. Everyone is saying this could be the year of the Lions that they will return, but they've never won this tournament since the last one they won in 2002. Coach Hugo Bruce is a Belgian. He's put together a great team, and he has the Lorient attacker there, Benjamin Mokanjo, to look forward to. They don't have all the established names like Eto'o of the past. They don't have all the trouble players like a lot of people would say, in their squad anymore. So it's a settled side, the young side, and the man is looking forward to that. But Cameroon will open against Burkina Faso. Burkina Faso are known as the Stallions. They were runners-up in 2013 to Nigeria. They're a fantastic side. They have a player that everyone in English Premier League probably knows. That's Bertrand Traoré. He became the youngest international for his country at the age of 15. He's on the books of Chelsea. He's on loan in the Netherlands with Ajax Amsterdam. But his brother, Bertrand Traoré, as well, they are a formidable side, but I think it's going to be difficult for them in that group. For me, I think Group A will probably end up with Gabon topping that group, Cameroon finishing second, Burkina Faso will probably finish third, and Guinea-Bissau will be lucky that they've come to an African party for the very first time.
Very interesting. Let's move on to Group B. We've got Algeria, Senegal, Tunisia, Zimbabwe. To me, this seems like the toughest group to pick. Would you agree?
A lot of people will say that, but you haven't seen the other group where you have Ivory Coast, DR Congo and Morocco in Group C. Here we are talking about three former champions. In Group B that you just mentioned now, Algeria, they are the 1990 African champions. They hosted in 1990, they won on home soil. But you're talking about a team blessed with so much attacking powers. They have Riyad Mahrez up front, they have Islam Slimani, they have Al Harabi, and everyone is saying, no, this is a formidable side. But they've had three managers in the last 6 months. that's not looking good for them. They had a Frenchman who had to leave. He said he wasn't feeling comfortable with that country because he had a lot of pressure from the press. And then in came Rajakov. He's a Serbian. And he left just after 3 months. And now they have George Lekins in charge. And George Lekins is trying as much as possible to, you know, restore confidence in the team again, because they did very well at the 2014 World Cup. But in qualification for the World Cup, like I said earlier, they've been struggling. They drew against Cameroon at home and they lost to Nigeria away. And there's so much pressure on George Lekin. So I think they are really, really going to have it tough in that group. It's not a compact side. Everyone says they have talent, but it's not a compact side. So it might really be difficult for them. In Senegal, you're looking at the team that finished runners-up in 2002. In 2002, they haven't really done well. Last time out in 2015, we had so much expectations, and now they have Sadio Mane, who's really in great form. In 2015, Sadio Mane was struggling for form. Now he's flying with Liverpool, and everyone will be hoping he can translate that form into the national side. Aliou Cisse is their manager. He's a former international. He's well known across Africa. They were unbeaten in African qualifiers, and they won all their matches. So you're looking at a side that will probably put in troubles for a lot of people there. They have Sheikh Kouyaté from West Ham. They have a whole lot of stars to look forward to there. And in Tunisia, you have the 2004 champions. They always do well at home, but when they go out, they struggle. In 2015, they proved everyone wrong. They went all the way, getting as far as the quarterfinals, where they faced the host country there. Remember that that's game that actually led to the referee, you know, making some questionable decisions, and the referee was eventually suspended because a lot of people felt he favored the host, the Equatorial Guinea. And Tunisia, you know, the players lost their heads and some of them were suspended and all of that, but they bounced back now under Henri Kaspariak. They have a veteran manager who knows everything about African football. He's coming to his 8th African Cup of Nations and he's highly experienced when it comes to that. They have Wabi Kashri from Sunderland to look at, and he's one player that will probably set them going. And of course, they have Heman Abdennour. Everyone is talking about him. He's flying with Valencia. Everyone expected him to come to the English Premier League. He didn't eventually make that trip, but he's one of their key stars there. And also, you have Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe is a funny one. They have undoubtedly one of the finest names in African football. They are known as the Warriors. But these Warriors have always, always struggle to actually come to the African party. The last time they came, that was in 2006, yeah? They finished in the second round, and it was unbelievable because back then they had a whole lot of stars that everyone was looking at. They have Benjamin Mariwari from Manchester City, remember him, and of course Portsmouth. But then they just left, they exited the tournament in the first round. Now they are coming again. They look very well under Kalisto Pasua, but they've been pitted in a group that is very, very difficult for them. They'll be lucky to get a point in Gabon, but they can look up to Knowledge Musona, who's flying in the Belgian league with Ostend. Everyone is talking about him in Belgium right now, and he's the top scorer, and he's that man that you want to turn to. But they would need more than Knowledge to succeed in Gabon.
So Group C for you is what they would call in some parts of the world as the group of death. Ivory Coast, Morocco, DR Congo, Togo. Ivory Coast, of course, defending champions. No Yaya Toure this time. Is that going to affect them a lot?
Well, they've struggled without Yaya Toure. Some people are convinced that they are shining without Yaya Toure, but I think they've struggled in qualifiers. Team group, they actually struggled. They only made it in the last game against Sierra Leone. Sierra Leone almost upset them there, and they haven't really looked convincing. They have Michel Dossier, who is saying to everybody that he has the best elephants ever assembled together. Remember, they won this tournament in 1992, and then they had to wait for the golden generation to achieve success. They couldn't achieve it without Didier Drogba, without all the other big stars. They eventually won in 2015. There's no Kolo Touré, there's no Yaya Toure. The brothers are out of there, and then Gervinho is out with injury. They've put together a young team. They've really, everybody calls it a signing. They've got Wilfried Zaha, and everyone is talking about Wilfried Zaha now because it started very well for them. Former England international, remember, is now playing for his bet country, Ivory Coast, and is a top signing for them. They still have Wilfried Bony up front, but you know, Jonathan Kogia, who is from Aston Villa, is the man to watch for the Ivorians there. but they have DR Congo. DR Congo finished third at the last tournament in 2015. They've been champions twice already. And Florent Mbenge is undoubtedly the finest local coach in African football right now and international football. Everyone is talking about him because his team, everyone says that the dark horses, and everyone is talking about them, that they could surprise a lot of people. They don't have Yannick Bolasie. They have the Omasi Mbokani from England as well coming into this tournament.
Oh, I think we've lost Oluwashina there. We'll try and get him back. Let's just see what we can do. We'll try and get Oluwashina back to talk about Group D in just a moment. Just before we do that, why don't we have a look at the fantastic interview we had yesterday. We were speaking to Isabel Musi, looking forward to the Australian Open. The full interview is at sportuccino.com. Have a look at that. And the thing with that interview is we were talking about Novak Djokovic. He's going for a record 7th title in Melbourne. And according to Isabel, she thinks that Djokovic is going to be back on form in Melbourne.
Previously on Sportuccino.
I think he's found his motivation back. I mean, you could see, I actually didn't see the match, but I've read a lot about his battle against Murray in Doha last Saturday. And obviously he's, he lost his temper quite a few times. And I think he was really eager to just show that he's still the boss of tennis. So I think we'll see the Djokovic we used to see. I think he's past his little crisis, you know, that that he had after winning Roland Garros and trying to find new goals to set up. And yeah, it'll be very interesting for sure.
So we're about to get Oluwashina back. Let's try and bring him back on the screen. There we go. Oluwashina, great to have you. Thanks for coming back. Let's quickly talk about Group D. So in Group D, we have got Ghana, Mali, Uganda, and Egypt. What do we expect to happen from that?
The return of Egypt is the talk of the competition. Egyptians are the most successful team at this tournament. They've won a record 7 titles, and you know, they have Mohamed Salah, he's playing for AS Roma. People in England will probably remember him for Chelsea when he was at Chelsea. And they have Hector Cooper in charge now, and Hector Cooper has actually molded them together. I've tipped them to win this tournament, and everyone think I'm crazy. But I think the return of the Egyptians is it's actually good for African football. They dominate. They won 3 titles in a row, and you don't see any other side that like a team. They are a compact team. They stopped Nigeria from coming to this tournament because they won that group involving Nigeria during qualification. So everyone is saying, yeah, they could potentially be a team to look at. But because they've been absent for so long, some people are questioning them. But I think they'll probably surprise a lot of people in Gabon. Then you have Ghana. Ghana have won titles. They have 4 titles to show for their own abilities. Everyone say Avram Grant hasn't really showed that this team can actually win the tournament, that they don't have the mentality to do it. They still have Asamoah Gyan as captain. They have Andre Ayew and his brother Jordan Ayew. Andre Ayew is the man that makes things work for Ghana. If he's at best, the Western player, if he's at his very best, Ghana could potentially be the team to watch. They were finalists at the last edition. They lost that remarkable shootout against Ivory Coast. But for me, I don't think they have the mentality to actually win this tournament. And then you have Mali, a young side. Mali, they've finished third place several times. And everyone is saying, look, Mali, they don't have all the former stars like, Seydou Keita, Momo Sissoko, you name them. Nowadays, they have young boys who've made it at the under-17 and under-20 level, but it's really, really difficult for them. They have an experienced manager in Alan Jures. He's coming into this tournament as well at the back of having attended 3 previous editions, and it's going to be really, really difficult for Mali in that group. Uganda, they're returning after a 39-year absence, runners-up in 1978, and I don't think we had black and I don't think we had color TV in Africa the last time they were at this tournament. So they're really coming back, and they have a manager in they have a Serbian manager who's really turned things around for them. But the Cranes will really struggle in that group, because I expect Egypt and Ghana to finish first and second in that group, and probably Mali third. It will be difficult for Uganda. But hey, what a nice way to have them back, because the Cranes, they've got colorful fans. They've got, they're unpredictable during qualifiers. Ghana always struggle against them. Egypt will tell you that as well. So we were looking at this tournament and saying, for another 2 years now, the last tournament in 2015 got everyone talking. This one in Gabon will get a whole lot of people talking, because the very best of African stars will be playing in this biennial tournament.
Fantastic. Yeah, I can't wait for it to start on Saturday. It's been so great to hear your knowledge, Oluwashina. Just quickly before you go, tell us how we can follow your fantastic journalism throughout the tournament via social media channels and anything else you'd like to promote, please.
Yeah, I'll be on. I'm always on Twitter. It's at Oluwashina, Oluwashina. I think that's the only place you can find me, because I'm rarely on Instagram. But that's the only place you can find me, and I'll be there giving updates from the tournaments, who are the stars to look at, who are the pre-tournament favorites, and all of that. I'll be talking about all that on Twitter every day during the tournament.
Perfect. Well, it's been so great to hear from you this morning, Oluwashina, talking everything to do with the Africa Cup of Nations. Thank you so much for your time this morning.
Thanks for having me, Richard, and have a great show.